Hey everyone, I'm Jamie and welcome. Are you tired of manually calculating numbers on your spreadsheet, spending way too much time with the calculator than typing the results back in? What if I told you Excel could do all that math for you automatically? In this video, we're going to cover the core concepts that will transform how you use Excel. We'll learn about formulas, Excel's pre-built functions, and a magic trick called cell referencing, including how to make your formulas flexible or how to lock them in place when you need to. By the end of this tutorial, you'll be able to build a simple budget tracker that updates itself. This is for the absolute beginner, so don't worry, we're going to take this step by step. Let's get started. All right, let's dive right in with formulas. Think of a formula as your personal calculator, built right into each cell of Excel. The most important rule to remember is this. Every single formula in Excel must start with an equal sign. That tells Excel, hey, I want you to calculate something. Let's select cell A1. I'm going to put the equal sign in to start with, saying, hey, you need to calculate something here. And I'm going to put a simple formula, 10 plus 5. And you can see right away, it calculated. If I click on the cell, I can always see the formula that I typed in right inside the formula bar up here. If I double click on it, it will show me the formula that's in it. So if I click off, it will go back to just what the answer is. If you want to subtract, you would put your equal sign in. Let's go 8 minus 6. You can see it's 2. If we want to multiply, we're going to be using the asterisk sign. So we'll say equals 8 multiply 5 is 40. And with divide, division, we're going to be using the forward slash. So we'll go equals 9 divided by 3 equals 3. And I do want to point out the order of operations matter here. So if I say equals 7 minus 5 multiply by 2, now in this case, it's not going to be 7 minus 5 multiplied by 2. It's going to be 5 times 2 is 10. And it's going to subtract 7. It's going to be a negative answer here. Negative 3. So remember, the order of operations matter. Now that's useful, but where Excel really shows its power is with cell referencing. Take a look at the table that I have right now. If you're following along, just pause the video and quickly type this out. You can see that we have a place to put our total, which would be the price multiplied by 3. I could go to this cell and type in, like I said before, we could put equals, I could put 199 multiplied by 3. And I get my answer. But what happens if the quantity changes or the price changes? Well, then I'd have to go back and redo the formula for everyone. And this is where you want to make sure you use cell referencing. I'm just going to delete this. And this time, again, we need to start with the equal sign. We are still going to do a calculation in here. I'm going to say equals, and I'm just going to select B2. I could type in B2 if I wanted to, but I'd like to just select. And so then I'm going to say what I want. This is going to be multiplication. I'll type my multiplication, the asterisk, and I'll click on quantity, and I'm going to hit enter. So I get the same answer, but the power is this. What happens if the quantity here turns to 7? And I hit enter, it automatically updates. Now you've turned this into a dynamic spreadsheet. The formula we just made uses what's called relative reference. Watch what happens when I click the little square at the corner of cell D2, the fill handle, and drag it down to D3. Excel automatically changed the formula in D3 to B3 times C3. The reference moved relative to the new cell. This is fantastic most of the times, but sometimes you need a cell reference to stay put. Let's add a sales tax calculation now. If I go up to F1, I'm just going to type tax rate here. And in G1, I'm just going to give a percentage, and I'm going to say 5%. Now, what I want to have happen, and I'm going to put the amount in this cell underneath the tax rate, I want to multiply the total here by the tax rate, 5%, and I should get my answer. Let's give it a try based on what I showed you. So if we say equals, I'm going to make sure I cell reference D2, we're going to multiply, we're going to go to the 5%, hit enter, and we get 70 cents. That worked out fine. Now, remember what I showed you before, when you drug down the formula by grabbing the handle here, dragging it down, and notice something didn't work right there. We have an error in there. Or let's see what happens. So if we double click on this, it shows me the different cells that got carried down. Now, this is correct. I wanted it to move to D3, but notice here, it also moved down. So it's under relative right now. I don't want this G2 to be relative. I want it to be absolute. So absolute is when you make it so it doesn't move. So how we do this, I'm gonna go and just delete these and we'll do it one more time. So I put my formula in. So we'll say D2, we'll multiply it by the 5%. Now, if I don't want this to move at all, to lock in place, I need to use dollar signs on in front of the G and the one, and it's not gonna move. A quick way to do this is to use the F4 key on your keyboard. If I press it once, it automatically adds the dollar signs to it. So I could go ahead and add the dollar signs to it, like by just by clicking on it, but the F4 key is a little bit of a shortcut to do that. I'm gonna hit enter, still got the same answer. Now, if I drag it down like this, look, now we have 20 cents. If I double click on this cell, G1, this is an absolute right here. So this did not move, but this one did move. If I wanted both not to move, I would have to put dollar signs around each of them. So this is a really important thing to know about when you're working with different formulas in Microsoft Excel. Now that you've mastered self-referencing, let's talk about functions. Functions are pre-built formulas that are right inside Microsoft Excel that do a lot of the heavy lifting for you. Let's start with a very simple common one, the sum function. And in the case here, we're just gonna sum up these two numbers. Now, the old way you could do it, just as self-referencing, hitting the equal sign and you select and you use your addition and so on and get this. Now, with using a function, I'm gonna show you a few different ways you can do this sum one. If I go ahead and put my equal sign in, and this is the way I use the most, but I'll show you others, I start typing sum. Here is my function that I want, and you can see adds all the numbers in a range of cells. So if I go ahead and select this one, I double clicked on it. Now we have the function, we have the parentheses, and inside the parentheses, you're gonna have the arguments. And the sum one's pretty easy because all we need to do is have a range. And the range here is just gonna be D2 to D3. So I could just type D2 to D3 in. So if I had a long list, I could type the top one and the bottom one. And a lot of times when I start the sum, it knows, it will just automatically sum that up. It will know the list. But I can go ahead and hit enter. And that's how easy it is to use the sum function. Another way you could use this, and I tell a lot of way for beginners to go up to here, is using this insert function. You can go and do a search up here for a certain function, and here's the sum one. If I go ahead and open this up, it walks you through step by step here, so it kind of explains it a little bit more. So as the functions get more complicated, this is a great way to kind of break up the different arguments that are inside the function. So in this case, I don't have to change much. I have the range here, so D2 to D3, that's gonna work fine. And then we have it here. So another way I could get to the functions, if I go over to formulas over here, notice that we have lots of different ones that we can go through here, and I'll explain a few of these. But if we go to auto sum and I just click on this, it knew right away, it grabbed all of them here, it gave me the range, and I could just go ahead and hit enter. But let's try a few more functions to just to show you the basics, so to get you started. If you're wanting to learn more about Excel, take a look at my other beginner Microsoft Excel videos. I'll put the links to them down below in the description and up above in the card. But now let's take the information that we've used and create our budget tracker. This is a pretty simple budget tracker. You can pause the video and just quickly type out what items that you feel would work for you the best. I'm just gonna use the functions inside Microsoft Excel to quickly do this now. So we have our cost here. I'm gonna go and do a total expenses. So in this case, this could be an auto sum or I could go to the sum, but I'm under formulas. I'm gonna click on auto sum. Is this the correct one? Well, we have an extra one in here. I'm just gonna make sure I select the area that I want and I hit enter. So right away, we have our total expenses. Now we can do other types of functions that are easy to from this drop down right here. Notice that we have average. So if I click average, is this what we want? No, we want to have this area selected. So I'm using ranges in these ones and I'm going to hit enter. For the number of items, we have a count option as well. So if I drop down, you can see that we have count numbers, and this will count how many entries. So you can see easily that this is 4 right here, but if you had a long list, this is where it becomes powerful. These different functions will quickly take care of these jobs for you with just a simple click. Now, I showed you this quick way here. You can do the same thing that I showed you before. We could use the equal sign, start typing in sum. We select our formula, select the argument, the range here, and we can go through each one. So even if I start typing equal, then average, you'll see that will be one of the different functions. I can go and select the area, and we can do more and more. These are just a shortcut up here. Now, if anything changes, this will all update automatically. Here's an example. Maybe your rent up goes up to $10,000. And you can see right away, the total expenses and the average expenses jump right up. The number of items doesn't change because we're still only listing 4 items. But this is the power of using functions in Excel. Every function has a name, like sum, followed by parentheses. Inside the parentheses are the arguments, the pieces of information the function needs. For sum, it's just that one argument that I showed you, the range of cells to be added. But many functions need multiple arguments. Let's look at COUNTIF. First, let's create a new simple list in column A, and you can see I have it typed out right here, and we'll look at one with multiple arguments before we leave here today. I have a very small list here of different fruits. I only have from A1 to A6 as my range, but I want to use a function to count how many times that apple appears in this. And I know I can glance at it and just do a quick count. I can see 3, but if you had a large list of thousands, you start to understand the power of Microsoft Excel. So we're gonna use a function called COUNTIF, and you're gonna see multiple arguments. And you could put this anywhere. I'm just gonna put this in B3, and I'm gonna start my different function here. So I'll put my equals in, and remember the other ways that I showed you as well. I'm gonna start typing COUNT, if, and I can see it's right here. So it counts the number of cells within a range that meets the given condition. So I'm going to select this, and it's really important to pay attention to this and follow the tips that they give you on this. So what's the range that we want? Well, the range is going to be this right here, A1 to A6. So that's going to be the first one, and then we're going to put the comma in, and notice now it moves to the criteria. So what's the criteria? I want it to count the word apple. So I actually have to type this in, but I need to use the quotation marks here. So I'm going to type apple, and I need to type it the way that it's being written in the list. So I'm just going to do this. Now, it's really important to get in the habit of closing your parentheses too. So if you have one open, you can see here, then the close will be here. As you get further on and understanding more Excel functions, you could have nested functions and side functions. We're not doing that in this tutorial here today, but do check out some of my other ones. So I'm just going to hit enter, and it went through the range, and the criteria was if it found apple, and it did 3 times. So there's an example of one with multiple arguments. So go ahead and give that a test. Start exploring, trying to go through piece by piece with the different functions to see how you can work with them and adding the information that's needed. So let's do a quick recap. You learned that formulas start with an equal sign, that relative cell references move when you copy them, and that absolute references lock in cell place. You also learned how to read function syntax using the tooltip, commas, and parentheses to unlock powerful shortcuts like sum and COUNTIF. The best way to learn is by doing it yourself. So try creating your own simple list and practice these skills. Thanks for watching this time on Teachers Tech. I'll see you next time with more tech tips and tutorials.